Ladies and gentlemen, as President Zuma said, civil rights continues to be the pivotal of debates in today's society, 2017. Despite the colorful skin, race, ethnicity, religion, even religious beliefs, we are still continuing to obviously hold these beliefs granted. Discrimination occurs in all aspects of society, and our distinguished speaker was involved in the civil rights movement as a 14-year-old in Birmingham, Alabama, often referred to as the most segregated city in the United States by Dr. Martin Luther King. His legacy as a civil rights activist continues today as the mayor of Alabama's largest city. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome for the first time in New England, first time in Connecticut, first time at CCSU, the Honorable Mayor and Civil Rights Activist, Mayor Bell.
Thank you, Professor, to the Honorable President of this institution, to the Vice President, the students who have gathered here, and all of the sponsors for this event. I thank you for the invitation to be here this afternoon, to speak to you. I'm always honored to have the opportunity to go around the country to share with people my experiences having grown up in Birmingham. All too often when people say the name of Birmingham, they think in terms of the 1960s Birmingham, the 60s where we had the riots and protests, where we had the snarling dogs, the hose pipes, and the kids being incarcerated. The Birmingham of today is very different than that Birmingham of the 1960s. But I'm also very proud of the fact that we do have a legacy there in Birmingham, a legacy that changed America. It started out with a belief that all human beings are endowed by God with certain rights, and certain they should be treated a certain way. And I always start off my discussions by sharing with individuals the difference between human rights and civil rights, because sometimes there's a confusion. People use the two interchangeably. Human rights are rights that are given to each one of us by our mere birth, by the fact that God made all of us equal in His sight, that we have the right to be treated with dignity, the right to be given certain deferences simply because we are human beings, and we all are equal. If you cut me or cut yourself, we all bleed the same blood. Our body parts are made up the same way, regardless. And so human rights is something that is of nature, is of a natural being. Civil rights is an attempt by mankind to codify or put into law how we treat each other and the opportunities that we have. I always tell someone that someone has to give you civil rights, but no one has to give you human rights, because you're born with human rights. And in the around the 1940s, there was a movement in the South of African Americans just wanting to be treated like human beings. Because prior to that time, African Americans were looked upon as a beast of burden. When you go back and look at how most African Americans came to the U.S., they came on slave ships. They were part of the economic system of the South. They were not given any human rights at all. They were considered to be chattel, property to be bought and sold for the good of the economy of the South. And as more and more African Americans came, and there was a divide on the issue between the North and the South, and a lot of people are under the misconception that that divide between the North and the South was based strictly on race and the treatment of African Americans, when in fact it was an economic conflict. You had most of the manufacturing taking place in the North, the Northeast. You had agriculture taking place in the South. That was a time when cotton was king. And in order to pick cotton or sugar cane or rice, it was labor intensive. And in order to keep the price of those commodities down, they needed slave labor. But in turn, they charged those manufacturing facilities in the north that were producing fabric, that was producing other products. They were charging them based on other price factors. And the north resented that. So they came into conflict as to the use of slave labor for economic benefit. I oftentimes hear people nowadays say, well, you know, I could have been a slave. You know, if I was back then, I would not let them treat me like a slave. Well, when you come from a different country, a different world, when you brought somewhere you don't know north from south, east from west, when you're isolated culturally, you're isolated from everything that you've known before, when if you did not follow orders, you were beaten within an inch of your life, you were isolated, put in a box, a hot box. Sometimes you were separated from your immediate family. You were treated in such an inhumane manner that all of your dignity was stripped away. And you could see why slaves acquiesced to their treatment, because they had no other choice. They had no other way. So I'm always amused when someone says, well, if I was a slave back then, I would not let them treat me that way. Well, in time, things began to change. We had the Civil War, and the Civil War changed, and there were a lot of laws imposed on the South during that period of time that prevented the South from having slaves, prevented the South from really governing themselves in a proper way. But around the early 1900s, you had a number of states, including Alabama, that were dissatisfied with the way the federal government was governing the southern states. And they started redoing their constitutions. And in Alabama today, we're governed by what's called the 1901 Constitution. And in that constitution, to this very day, there are laws that prohibit me as an African American from doing certain things, like interracial marriage, holding certain jobs, walking on the same side of the street as a white person. All of these are laws that exist today, but they're unconstitutional. But the state of Alabama has not changed those laws. But in 1901, there was an attempt by the legislature to codify how African Americans should act and behave in society, and how you could restrict their ability to hold jobs and to take care of themselves. It was put into law. And those laws perpetuated the segregated society, not a slave society, but a segregated society, meaning that you have your world and we have our world. And when those two worlds interact, this is the type of behavior that's governed by the 1901 Constitution we expect to be carried out. That law also applied to whites in terms that they could only treat blacks a certain way. If a white person tried to leave property to an African American, on many occasions it was challenged. You couldn't live in certain neighborhoods because of your race. There were a number of things that 1901 law affected whites as well as blacks. Well, as blacks began to become more educated, because if you recall, in slavery, you were not allowed to teach an African-American how to read. That was another way to keep you isolated and to keep you ignorant of being able to learn things about your destiny or how to control your own destiny. But as African-Americans began to become more educated, more enlightened, this concept of human rights came about. And this concept of treat me like a man, don't treat me like an animal, treat me like a man, treat me like a woman. And voices began to rise up, talking about the African-American experience here in America, not just in the South, but all over America. W.E.B. Du Bois, Frederick Douglass, other individuals, they had these discussions about what direction African-Americans should go in terms of attaining true equality in America. There were certain issues that arose in the treatment of African Americans, such as the riding public transportation. Many of you may be aware that in Montgomery in the mid to late 50s, there was the Montgomery bus boycott, in which a young lady by the name of Rosa Parks, how many of you have heard of Rosa Parks? Rosa Parks is the young lady that's credited with starting the civil rights movement, in that African Americans, when they rode public transportation on buses, they had to ride in the back of the bus. And oftentimes, because of the way the bus system was set up and the workforce that the African Americans made up, they were the majority of people riding on the bus. But if more whites got on the bus, they had a little portable sign that they could move from the front of the bus to the back of the bus. On one side of that sign it said white, on the other side it said color. So if you had only, let's say, 6 whites on that bus and 30 African Americans, usually they had the sign up front and probably the first 2 rows on the bus were reserved for whites. And as more and more whites got on the bus, they would take that sign and they would move it. And if they moved it behind you, you had to get up and move behind that sign to make way for the white individual who got on the bus to sit there. And if more and more whites got on, they continued to move that sign. And you, if you were African American, you were crowded in the back of the bus. And if it got too crowded, they would actually make individuals get off the bus. It kind of reminded me of that United Airlines situation. It's amazing how the more things change, the more they remain the same. But it was that type of situation that Rosa Parks said, no, I'm not going to take this anymore. And she refused to get up when they moved that sign when a white male got on the bus. She was arrested. She was taken to jail. And a protest movement around her arrest took place. There were a number of ministers who came together to support Ms. Parks. And most of them were older ministers. But they felt like they needed a young voice to be the lead. You know, young folks crazy, they'd do anything. So they reached out and they got a young preacher by the name of Martin Luther King and said, we want you to help lead this protest for Ms. Rosa Parks being arrested. That's how Dr. King came to the forefront. And he gained a reputation throughout Alabama, throughout the South, as being someone who was a good organizer of protest movement. And Dr. King was called to various places around the South to speak. But he didn't have the national reputation or the international reputation that we know he has today. But locally he was known. He was known among black ministers, and he was oftentimes called in to help with situations. Dr. King had gone to, I believe it was Macon, Georgia, to help lead a protest movement over in Macon, Georgia. This was around 60, 61, somewhere along in there. He ran into fierce opposition there in Macon, Georgia, and some people say he ran out, but he didn't have the impact that he wanted to have in Macon, Georgia. But in Birmingham, Alabama, there was a gentleman by the name of Fred Shuttlesworth, who was the pastor of Bethel Baptist Church in Collegeville, who in the 50s and 60s were leading protest marches to try to integrate our school system, protest marches to try to integrate our public spaces like our parks. And he was not having very much success. But at the time, he was causing such a ruckus in the community, there really was a bounty on his head. His church had been bombed several times. His home had been bombed. In fact, on one occasion, his home was bombed and the entire house collapsed down around him while he was still in his bed. The whole house was blown up, and all he had was a little cut on his ear. And he said that he was protected by God. And that took away all of his fear. Because if you can imagine being in a bomb blast and everything around you was blown apart, And you're there in your bed. Only God and God's angel were there to protect you. And from that point on, Fred Shuttlesworth said he had no fear of death, because he knew that God was protecting him. Well, he continued to march and protest, and he was severely beaten in front of a school called Phillips High School for wanting to enroll his children at that particular high school. And things got rather dangerous for Fred Shuttlesworth, but that did not deter him. Now, throughout the Southeast, Dr. King was getting widely known for his organizing efforts. So Fred Shuttlesworth reached out to Dr. King to invite him to come to Birmingham. And Dr. King originally said, no, I'm not coming to Birmingham, you know. I dealt with the sheriff over in Macon County, and that was a tough city, the city of Macon, and that was a tough situation. And y'all got a nut over there that's even worse than that guy. His name is Bull Connor, and I'm not coming to Birmingham. And Fred Shuttlesworth was very persistent. He said, no, you got to come. You got to come. Because while you're running all over the South, going to all these different cities, Birmingham, which at the time was considered to be the most segregated city in America, that if you could break the back of segregation in Birmingham, it would fall all across the South. And finally, he convinced Fred Shuttlesworth convinced Dr. King to come to Birmingham for the organization of the marches and the protests. And Dr. King came, the first time that I remember him coming, was in 1962. And there was a church called New Pilgrim Baptist Church, which was not too far from our city jail and not too far from the neighborhood that I lived. And it was one Thursday evening, I'm sorry, it was one Wednesday evening. I'm outside playing with my friends in the neighborhood, and all of a sudden my grandmother said, Anthony, come on inside. Yeah, my middle name is Anthony. Anthony, come on inside. Get washed up, you're going with me. Now that was, you know, I'm playing with my friends. Why I gotta get washed up and dressed up to go somewhere on a Wednesday evening? Well, those of you who are Protestants, you know, well, at least in the South, I don't know how it is up north, but Wednesday, that's church day. That's church evening. You go go to church on Wednesday, you study the Bible and things of that nature. But they had a very special guest on this particular occasion. It was Dr. Martin Luther King. He was speaking there at New Pilgrim Baptist Church. My grandmother wanted me to go with her. And at the time that I was there, I didn't know anything about segregation, didn't know I was being discriminated against. Yeah, I had school books that were 15, 20 years old, but it didn't register in my mind that I was being discriminated against. Yes, if I had to go to a restroom at a department store, I had to go down in the basement to use the colored restroom, but it didn't dawn on me that I was being discriminated against. Yes, I knew that as I got older, if I got an education, most of that I could hope for would be to work in the mines or steel mill at hard labor, unless I became a minister or something like that. But it didn't register in my head. The life that I lived was not the type of life that any human being should live. So she took me to New Pilgrim Baptist Church. I heard Dr. King speak on that particular occasion, and the hairs on the back of my neck stood up because of the power of his words and the passion with which he spoke. And on that occasion, there were two gentlemen. Both were from Alabama. One was from Birmingham. One was named Tommy Wren, and the other was James Orange. And both of them were older teenagers. In fact, probably either late teens or early 20s. And they were organizers with Dr. King who got hold of young folks to really tell them about what it takes to overcome segregation in our community. And my grandmother turned me over to these two gentlemen, and they began to lecture me on what segregation was really all about, what discrimination was all about, and the fact that we had to speak up and speak out, and that there was danger and there was fear, but we could not meet violence with violence. That our power was in unity, and our power was standing up to brute force, knowing that our lives may be in danger. Dr. King began to plan what was called Project C, and that C stood for confrontation. He knew that in order to break the back of segregation, you had to get those quiet white folks engaged. Because most of the Klan, most of the people who were the enforcers of segregation were either poor whites or whites who would be considered to be middle class labor pool. But the upper echelon of the white community, they really were solid. They didn't say anything, they didn't do anything one way or the other. They just went about their life like nothing else was wrong. This is the way it is, this is the way it always will be. So Dr. King figured that in order to make the real changes in Birmingham that was necessary, we had to engage the upper echelon of the community, the keepers of the law, the keepers of society, the ones that make society work. And how do you do that? You impact the economy. And so we began the process of having sit-ins in the various department stores. We began to challenge the system in which we were living by going down each day and sitting at counters that were reserved for whites only, or using the white restroom, or drinking out of the white fountain. All of those things were against the law because of the 1901 Constitution. And the adults were the ones that originally went down in the marches. But as they were being arrested, they were threatened with the loss of their jobs as well. And the second time around, the adults said, well, no, I'm not going back because, you know, I got fired from my job, but my boss tells me that if I stay away from all these protests, he'll have me back. Or I can go back to work in the household or doing the things that I did before this, so I can't go back. So Dr. King and Dr. Shuttlesworth and Ralph Abernathy and the other leaders of the movement, they devised this plan to get the young people involved. Because young people weren't working, so they weren't afraid of being fired from their jobs. And you could get enough in mass to go down and stop all of the various department stores from doing business as usual. And they went to an institution called Miles College, which was on the western side of town. And there was a dean of students, by the name of Dr. McPherson. And Dr. McPherson gathered all the students at Miles College, and they started walking from Miles College, which was like 20 miles from downtown Birmingham. They started marching from Miles College. And as they made their way to downtown, they stopped by all of the different high schools, picking up kids. Now, it was the kids did not have permission to leave school, but the principals would turn their backs. In fact, one principal said, well, you know, I'm going to the restroom and I'm going to be gone for about 10 or 15 minutes. Y'all better be here when I get back. Well, naturally, by the time the principal got back, the students were gone. So they collected students at every high school that they passed by. The high school that I attended was a Catholic high school. It was called Immaculata High School. And by the time they got to my school, and it was only about 3 miles from downtown, there were a mass of students marching, singing, protesting. They got to my school, and the head of my school, which was a white Josephite priest, he locked all the doors. He didn't do like the other principals at the other school, saying, well, I'm going to the restroom. Y'all better be here when I get back. He didn't do that. He locked all the doors and had all the windows secured. Some students got out. I was not one of the students that got out on that particular day. Well, after the marchers left my school, he pulled all the remaining students into the gymnasium. And he said, now, I know that you all are upset, because what we were thinking, well, why is this white man, white justified priest, why is this white man forbidding us from going downtown to protest for our rights, for our human and civil rights? He's part of the system. He doesn't want us to be free. He doesn't want us to go down and protest. Well, Father Eugene Farrell took us into the gym, and he said, I know you're upset with me, and I know you wanted to go. He said, but first of all, none of you have permission to leave school from your parents, and I'm responsible for you. Secondly, what you have to understand, a change is going to come. A change is going to come to Birmingham. A change is going to come to the South. And it's my responsibility to make sure that each one of you are prepared for that change, that each one of you are prepared to take your rightful place in society and show those who would oppress you that you have the skills, the ability, the intellectual capacity to be just as responsible as they are. Now, we're teenagers. We weren't buying none of that stuff. Here, still, you got this white guy telling us we can't go and protest. I'm going to come back to Father Farrell after a while. So we didn't go down on that particular occasion, but there were other occasions that we just didn't go to school, and we went down and we participated in the march. Well, now this was over a 5 or 10 day period of time. The jails were filling up, because you're talking about some 15 to 20,000 students that were marching. The jails were filling up. And finally, when my opportunity to go down to march came, all the jails and all the spaces that they could use to house students were already filled up. So they didn't arrest anybody on that day. I was really disappointed about that. Dr. King came, and on that Good Friday, before Easter of 1963, he was arrested and taken to the jail cell. And as I was telling Professor Marcoran, Dr. King could have gotten out of jail that same day. He could have gotten out of jail at any point in time that he wanted to. But he said that he would not leave jail. He would remain in jail until every last one of those students were released from jail. Now, the students had a $50 bond on them. Now, we don't know. Y'all probably think $50, that's not a lot of money. But in 1963, African-American in Birmingham, Alabama, $50 was like saying $500 or $5,000. That was a lot of money. And each student of the thousands of students had a $50 bond on them before they could get out. There was a gentleman by the name of Harry Belafonte. You all heard of Harry Belafonte? Mr. Dale. Dale. He said, Dale. He like, oh man, you want to go home. Great actor. He, along with Sidney Poitier, Sammy Davis Jr., and a number of notable, visible entertainers, went out all across the country and raised the money necessary for each one of those kids to get out of jail. And it wasn't until that happened that Dr. King stepped out of jail of his own recognizance. During that period of time, Dr. King wrote on some toilet paper the letter from the Birmingham jail. Anybody here read the letter from the Birmingham jail? That document is considered to be one of the most important treaties ever written on why it was important to rise up against the segregated society that had been created. That document was in response to an editorial that, I don't know if it was 50 ministers or 100 ministers, had signed off on in the Birmingham News asking Dr. King to leave Birmingham. They said, you know, well, you know, we're working on our problems. We know we got problems. If you just leave and let us solve our own problems, we'll be fine. And if you just wait, change will eventually come. And the essence of his letter was that we can't wait. You can't wait while injustice still prevails. And that it was important that he, along with everyone else, stayed focused on ending the tyranny against African Americans. Now, let me remind you again, this wasn't like the protest march that we had just a couple of days ago, the March for Science, or the women's march that we had back in January, or some of the other marches that we have. You had a government-sponsored terror group known as the Birmingham Police Department and the Birmingham Fire Department, who turned the hose pipes, who turned the dogs on those kids, biting them on the legs, stripping the skin off with the power of those hose pipes. With that backdrop, you also had bombings that were going on in the city itself. In my neighborhood, there were 3 bombs that went off, 2 in one night. It was about 7 o'clock one evening. All the kids were in the house, because back then you had a rule. If you were a kid, you had to be walking in the door when the streetlight came on. That was your curfew. And so we were at home, and all of a sudden, there was a bomb blast that shook the house, and it froze everybody. My father was home, my mother was home, but you could feel it all throughout the neighborhood. Nobody went outside. About 10 minutes after that bomb went off, a second bomb went off in the same area. And what the individual who planted that bomb wanted to do, the first bomb was to lure people outside to see what was going on, what was that explosion. The second bomb that was filled with shrapnel, nails, BBs, and things of that nature, it was designed to maim and kill. And you had bombs going off all over the city in a relatively short period of time, not on that same night, but 1 week here, another week there, you had bombs going off. That's why Birmingham got the name Bombingham. And so with that backdrop, it wasn't just a matter that we said, oh, let's go downtown and protest. You actually had to put your life on the line, because you didn't know whether you were going to be maimed, killed, permanently incarcerated, blinded. You didn't know what was going to happen to you, but you went anyway. While Dr. King was in Birmingham, after he got out of jail, he began to plan the March on Washington. And that took place, the actual planning of the March on Washington actually took place in Birmingham, Alabama at the A.G. Gaston Motel. Also during that period of time, there was a young guy by the name of John Lewis who was leading protests down in Selma, Alabama. And he tried to march from Selma to Montgomery. And the first time he marched, he was stopped. He was stopped by the Alabama State Troopers and was severely beaten. They got a lot of the black and white film footage of that. He, along with the other protesters. Well, he reached out to Dr. King to say, we need your help down here in Selma. Just like you're helping up there in Birmingham, we need your help down here in Selma, because we want to march from Selma to Montgomery to protest at the state capitol the treatment of African Americans. Now, I use the term African Americans, but back then, you either colored or black, or the N-word. So Dr. King met with John Lewis, and he helped organize the second march. And that's the march that you see the massive crowd of people behind Dr. King, behind Jesse Jackson, behind Andrew Young, and all the other individuals who went down to march with John Lewis. That was the actual second march. Bloody Sunday was the first march in which John Lewis was beaten. Well, as they were planning the March on Washington, and if you recall, the March on Washington took place that summer, the summer of 63, it brought out tens of thousands of people from all over the world to really protest the segregated South. That angered a lot of individuals in Birmingham. They said, we're going to send a real message this time. And so one Sunday morning, September 15th, 1963, at about 10:05 in the morning, I was at home, getting ready to go to church. My mom was had just finished giving us breakfast, and she was getting ready to go to church. My dad was also. And we heard this blast. And again, it shook the house, shook the neighborhood. Dishes was falling out of the pantry and things of that nature. But it was different than any other bomb explosion that we had ever heard before. And soon on the radio, we began to hear that 16th Street Baptist Church had been bombed. And we began to hear that there were fatalities. My dad, along with other individuals, they got in the car and he stopped and he waited for me to come and go with him. And we drove down to 16th Street Baptist Church. And the entire east wall of the church had been blown out. They were pulling bodies out of the church. Ambulances were coming from all over. And we knew that some people had been killed, but we didn't know who. And as we began to hear the names of the individuals later on that were killed, it was like those four little girls touched the entire city in terms of having some personal relationship with them. For example, Carol Roberts is a second cousin of mine. So that it's a personal relationship. Denise McNair was in my brother's class. I think they were in like the fourth or fifth grade. Everybody, every African American throughout the city had some relationship with Addie, with Denise, with Carol. I mean, they had some relationship with the four little girls that it just touched us in a way that you just could not explain it. And it also went around the world that here on a Sunday morning, as these four little girls were getting ready for church, Sunday school, in a place, a holy place, a sanctuary, a place that you send up your voices to praise God, a place that you pray, a place of sanctuary, that someone had so much hatred in them that they would set a bomb indiscriminately to kill and maim whoever it killed or maimed. And the inhumanity of something like that sent a message not only around the world, but it sent a message to those in leadership in Birmingham, Alabama, that we can't have a society that would allow a sanctuary to be bombed on a Sunday morning. We can't be representative of a community that would allow our children to be sacrificed on the altar of hatred. We've got to make some changes. So they set about the process of changing city government, of changing the laws of separation or segregation in the community. And it was a political battle. But finally, you had some white voices that said, we got to make the changes. Voices who were in positions of power that could help those changes come about. And that led to the integration of our school system. I was one of the first African Americans to attend a white Catholic high school because I transferred from my black Catholic high school to a white Catholic high school. Yes, Catholics were segregated too. And there was a lot of pressure on me to perform. There was a lot of pressure because in the African American community, we thought, and it was instilled in us, that whites are smarter than we are. Whites have better opportunities than we do. Whites know more. They just automatically know more. And so when I was put in that situation at my white Catholic high school, it was a little intimidating. But I remember what Father Farrell had said on that day that he refused to let us out of the school, because I was a freshman in high school then. Remember, there's a change that's going to come, and it was his responsibility to prepare us for that change so that we could show people that we could perform, we could take on responsibility, we could achieve. His voice was in the back of my head. So on that first day of school, at the predominantly white school, I wanted to show them that I could perform, that I could live up to the expectation that every student should have. Study hard, work hard, make good grades, and you can achieve. Later on, I was one of the first individuals to work for the Xerox Corporation in Birmingham, Alabama. They had a program to reach out and hire, well, I'm skipping some because I didn't even take it through my college years, but professionally, I used to work for the Xerox Corporation, one of the first African Americans there. And again, in the back of my head was Father Farrell's voice saying, you can't achieve. It's my responsibility to make sure that you have the skills to show the world that just because of your color, that does not hold you back. You can achieve just like anyone else. Let me step back a little bit. In 1969, there was a young man killed in Vietnam. His name was Bill Terry. And Bill had written in his will, because anytime you go into a military combat zone, they ask you to fill out, you know, a will as to where your personal effects and things like that and your last wishes, because you don't know whether you're going to live or die. But Bill had indicated in his documentation and also in a letter to his mother that if anything happened to him, he wanted to be buried in Elmwood Cemetery. Elmwood Cemetery was probably one of the most exclusive cemeteries in Birmingham at the time, and not too far. I mean, it was actually in my neighborhood. It wasn't too far from where I lived. And so Bill wanted to be buried there. Bill was one of the students that got locked in the school on that day that Father Farrell would not let us go down in March, years earlier. Well, Father Farrell was the person who organized the march to force the owners of Elmwood Cemetery to allow Bill Terry to be buried there. Father Farrell was the one to help raise the money for the lawsuit that Bill's mother filed against the cemetery owners to allow Bill to be buried there. And it took 2 or 3 years. Now, this is just the late 60s, early 70s. It took two or three years. But he eventually was allowed to be the first person to be buried at Elmwood Cemetery. And that caused a big ruckus in the community. But that was the kind of commitment that Father Farrell had, and it changed all of our minds, you know, the students of the students who had gone on to graduate, it changed our minds as to what Father Farrell really was all about, the tools that he gave us to be successful, his commitment to making sure that right was being done by Bill Terry and Bill's family. And so that changed my attitude along with other students' attitude. My grandmother, the one that I spoke of earlier that took me to New Pilgrim Baptist Church, she actually lived in New York. But every summer, either she would come to Birmingham or we would go to New York. And I would spend half my summers up in New York and the other half would be down in Selma. As I was telling Dr. Barbaran, it was kind of a culture shock to go from Birmingham to New York, but it was also a culture shock to go from Birmingham to Selma. Well, my grandmother had always instilled in me a sense of knowing about politics. She said that everyone has an obligation, a civic obligation, to understand what politics is all about and understand how politics govern and affect their life. And you know, sometimes you hear people say, I don't want to be bothered with politics. Politics leave me alone and I leave politics alone. Well, she said politics govern your life from the time that you're born until the time that you die. It determines what hospital you're going to, the quality of the hospital you're in. It determines where you can be buried. And everything in between. When you got in your car and you came here today, or you got on a bus and you rode on the streets of New Britain and you stopped at a traffic light, politics governed whether or not that traffic light was going to be there. Politics governed whether or not you were going to have potholes in the street. Politics governed every aspect of each one of our lives. And she said that if you're going to be aware and knowledgeable, you have to understand what politics is all about and have civic engagement in politics. And so from that point, I was always aware of politics and I always had a sense of wanting to give back. And eventually I got involved in the political process because I wanted to make changes in my community, and we were able to make those changes. I Got elected to the Birmingham City Council in 1979, long before many of you all were born. I became interim mayor in 1999. I became a county commissioner in 2009 and eventually became the mayor of the city of Birmingham in 2010-2011. Now, why is that significant? Because I lived up to the promise and the potential that Dr. King had marched for, that Bill Terry died for it in Vietnam, that Father Farrell knew would come about if I applied myself. All of those individuals who sacrificed, who marched, gave me the opportunity to be where I am today, even standing on this stage speaking to you. So I'm grateful to all the men and women, the boys and girls, who stood up at the right time, at the right moment, to give each one of us in this room the opportunities that we have today. So I just wanted to share that with you, and I'll be happy to entertain any questions that you all might have about life in Birmingham and about how things changed and whether or not there's still a need for change today. So I'll be happy to entertain any questions that you might have.
Thank you guys, what an interesting story. The history of civil rights here at CCSU. Let me ask some of the first questions to kind of bring the icing up. Immigration is also the icing issue in this country, which is so divided with immigration right now. Your city is a welcome city. You led the movement on that. Our city and our campus is a safe city, a sanctuary city, as we say. My question to you, what's your take on immigration, the Great Divide, and with Dr. King support for the sanctuary cities and so forth, what
do you say about
immigration?
Well, I think Dr. King's attitude and my attitude as well, that the only non-immigrant are the Native Americans. The rest of us, we are all immigrants that came from somewhere else to this great country. And America was really created out of immigration. Now, there does need to be an orderly, legal way for people to come into this country. But for those individuals who are here in this country, I think they need to be treated like human beings. The principle of human rights still exists. And I think we need to work to find a fair and decent way that all individuals can reap the benefit that this great country has to offer.
Thank you. Questions, my students?
How do you think civil rights have changed compared to when Dr. King was around as civil rights movements like Black Lives Matter?
Yeah, very good question. You know, down through the years, I've seen situations come about that still put pressure on our society to make the changes necessary. And by that, back in the late 60s, early 70s, after integration came about, and integration at the college level was taking place all across the country, they had what they call a quota system, whereby they were allowing African Americans to come in at a certain percentage to various universities. Then there was a lawsuit filed against the University of California, I don't know whether it was California Berkeley or California Long Beach or wherever, by Bakke. It was Bakke versus the University of California, that said that quotas were racially discrimination in and of themselves, because for every African American you let in school, that meant that there was one white person that did not get in the school. So there's always been a push and pull situation with civil rights and human rights. We see that today with rights that are being restricted. I heard earlier today that the current administration is trying to eliminate some of the presidential executive orders as it relates to LGBT issues. You're going to continue to have that push and pull. But I think there's going to be a continued struggle, a continued push towards equality for all people. That's just the nature of our society. at some point in time, you're going to have somebody to push back. But I think the greater will of the people is that for everyone to be treated equally and fairly.
Birmingham Police Department, Fire Department, of course, Terror Squad back in the Civil Rights Movement. Yeah. Modern day times, we have a Ferguson effect that's going on where there's a mistrust between minorities and the police. What's Birmingham going to mitigate that mistrust between the minority population and law enforcement?
Very good question. during President Obama's last year in office, he put together 6 municipalities, the mayors and the police chief, of which the city of Birmingham was one, because we have a model training program for our police officers. Being a city that has experienced racial conflict, being a city that the police department was known to be the armed enforcement of segregation, we knew that we had to change the image of our police department. Every police officer, black or white, Hispanic or whatever, they have to go through a sensitivity training program. And I think professor here has taken students to our Civil Rights Institute in Birmingham. Well, our police officers have to go to that facility. They have like 3 or 4 days of sensitivity training so that they, when they come up on a situation, we don't want them to see a perpetrator. We don't want them to see a criminal. The first thing we want them to see is a human being. Now, after they see that human being and they assess the situation, they may end up seeing a criminal, but we don't want the first reaction to be, well, I'm looking at a criminal. We want that first reaction to be, I'm looking at a human being. And going back to your question about Black Lives Matter, all too often into our society, we see people in their caricature, as opposed to seeing that human being that I talked about. I was asked to go to Ferguson after Michael Brown was killed by the Justice Department and some of the local mayors. And what we found out there was that the police department was made up by people who did not live in the community. It was not controlled by the mayor's office. It was controlled by a police commission at the county level. They hired and fired all of their officers. I mean, that was their role. The mayors had nothing to do with the police department at all. The way they got funding for the police department was through the fines and court cases that they brought against people. In Birmingham, I don't know how it is up here, but if you got a taillight out and a police officer stopped you, either taillight or headlight, you have 72 hours to get that taillight fixed. If you get it fixed, you take it to a police officer, they check it out, they null and void the ticket. In Ferguson, didn't matter whether or not you were going to get it fixed, you had to go to court, which meant that you automatically were going to have to pay a court fine, the cost of going to court, in addition to the fee for having the light out. And all of that money that was collected went back into this police commission fund that paid the police officers their salary and their bonuses. So if you're a police officer and you know that your pay is tied to how many tickets you write, you're going to be out there writing tickets every day. And when the confrontation came up with Mike Brown, it wasn't because Mike Brown had a confrontation at the Quick Mart or at the little convenience store. It was because Mike Brown was jaywalking. And that officer saw, quick ticket, little money coming in. That's what that was all about. So Birmingham is playing a role in trying to change the policing policies that exist all across the country due to President Obama pulling those 6 cities, 6 police departments together. Now, whether or not that's going to continue under the current administration, we don't have any idea, but we're still meeting. Yes.
Yeah, see how there's some leadership conflicts. Mm-hmm. I see. Yeah.
Alabama Human Rights Commission. Actually, NAACP was outlawed in the state of Alabama. And what happened, they threw the leadership for the NAACP in jail, and they banned them from even staying in the state of Alabama. And that's when you had the rise of the Alabama Human Rights Organization, as well as SCLC. Traditionally, SCLC are the people who are in the streets. They're the tree shakers. They're the ones that go to confrontation and things of that nature. Traditionally, the NAACP is the arm that do the work inside the legal structure. That's where you had Thurgood Marshall, Arthur Shores, and other individuals working through the NAACP Legal Defense Fund to attack the laws that were in place that allowed segregation and discrimination to take place. So they had distinctive roles, but in Alabama, NAACP was actually banned for a number of years. Remember, they were with the White House. You know, very, very good question. I have mixed emotions like you do. I think intellectually I can compete against anybody at any time, anywhere. But I also know that sometimes that opportunity to compete is closed off to you. When you have legacy situations that if your grandfather went to the University of Alabama, then you can go to the University of Alabama. But if my grandfather never even had a high school education, how can I be a beneficiary of that legacy? I mean, there's affirmative action. We don't call it affirmative action. I think at either Yale or Harvard, maybe both. If you got a parent that went there or an ancestor, you get admitted. Well, that's a form of affirmative action by another name. Sometimes a group, a class of individuals need that assistance to get in the door. Now, whether or not they stay in the door is dependent upon the individual and their abilities and skills. Should it last forever? No. It should be evaluated from time to time to see if affirmative action is still needed. Are you getting a good mix of students or employees based on just the general population of their own ability? Or do you have to put in place special programs that will encourage those individuals to come and be a part? I think you do, but should it last forever? No. And should it be the sole determinant? No. And that's just my feeling on it.
I have two more quick questions. One on the back.
First, two quick connections with your beautiful city. I've been there. I was invited on behalf of Jefferson County to select supervisors.
Yes.
It was a well-run operation. I commend you on that to ensure that impartiality and selection of police supervisors in Birmingham. And also, your chief of police, A.C. Wilbur, was my commanding general, no longer in the unit.
Mm-hmm.
Two-star general is an outstanding example of what my looks like in police. So kudos to you. My question to you is, as Dr. Balcon has talked about being a sanctuary city and all the threats that have been placed upon them in terms of federal dollars, how are you prepared to deal with that? Would you consider any type of litigation against the federal government or the president as a recourse to that action? How are we going to deal with that potential loss of federal dollars?
Bill de Blasio, the mayor of New York, is taking a lead role in challenging the Trump administration as well as the Justice Department. We have agreed and we're meeting with Mayor de Blasio in formulating a legal challenge to the directives that the Trump administration has given through executive orders. We feel that what they're proposing is unconstitutional. I think just the other day, Jeff Sessions, who unfortunately from the state of Alabama, put out an edict saying that not only would they try to recapture or stop federal dollars going to any city, state, or county that has sanctuary cities, that they would try to go back and recapture money already spent by those cities, which is also unconstitutional. So that will be a legal challenge made up of cities that agree with Bill de Blasio's position that the president does not have that kind of power, and we're going to fight it every step of the way that we can.
We have a last question.
Hey. Thanks for stopping by, by the way. I guess with all the young minds that are in this room or in that are still educating themselves today, what would be like your grand scheme plan for like a lot of the different problems that are happening in our today's society? Like currently right now, there's bombings in Jewish communities. You got, you know, we're still trying to fix the whole police and the community thing. And then we've got the immigration. Like, do you think, because you had your leader for, you know, MLK and a couple of others. So what do you think our, I guess, society would need? Do you think we would need one leader or, you know, what would that be?
Here's
your leader.
Well, leadership has systematically been compromised. And by that, I spoke earlier about the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. In Birmingham, we had a law firm called Adams Baker Clemens, ABC. All three of those individuals were great civil rights lawyers, great labor lawyers. They were winning lawsuits left and right for discrimination, lawsuits for unjust laws, different things. But each one of those individuals were made judges, and it destroyed that law firm. Now, it was good for them individually that they got into a position of power, but then there wasn't a strong legal voice in the community to be able to take those cases. And so you had a dilution of the skill set in the community of leaders to come out there. But leadership will find its way. Someone in this room may not know it right now, but time and circumstance may put one of you in a position that you have to show leadership based on your skills and ability. And it will happen. It will occur. But you know, I just can't say, well, you're a leader or I'm a leader. Leadership will find its own course in its own way.
Before we let this go, I want to present a gift from all of my class.
On behalf of Central Connecticut State University, we would like to give you this little token of our appreciation for you coming and speaking about civil rights to us.
Well, thank you so much. Let me just say one thing finally. Professor Barberman, he's brought many students to Birmingham and Atlanta, Memphis, and other places that are the centers of the civil rights movement. I appreciate his efforts, and for those of you who have an opportunity to make one of those trips, please do so, because it'll change your mind about the South, it'll change your mind about the people who live there and what we're doing today. It's not about the dogs and the hose pipes. It's not about keeping one people down, but it's about everyone living up to their own potential and having the ability to lead the quality of life that they choose. And so that's what we're all about in Birmingham, and I hope I have the opportunity to welcome you all to my city, a city that I'm proud of. I want to publicly thank Steve for his efforts to bring us all together. So thank you.